This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're broadcasting from Park City TV in Utah, home of the Sundance Film Festival, as we turn to one of the most buzzed about films here at Sundance. It tells a story that you might expect to see in one of the documentaries here, but instead it's a drama that portrays the true story of the last day of Oscar Grant's life. Oscar Grant was the 22-year-old Bay Area resident who was shot to death on BART, the Bay Area Rapid Transit, by a police officer on New Year's Day in 2009. It was the night of 2008 into the morning of 2009. The incident prompted widespread outrage in Oakland after cell phone video footage of the shooting was uploaded to YouTube. One video was downloaded 500,000 times in 4 days after Oscar was killed. The footage shows Oscar Grant and several other young African-American men being subdued by the BART officers at an Oakland area train stop. Grant does not appear to be resisting arrest when he's shot in the back while being handcuffed. The new film here at Sundance that begins with this real cell phone footage and then dramatically rewinds to earlier in the day, it's called Fruitvale, named after the train stop where Oscar Grant died. This is a clip from Fruitvale when Oscar Grant speaks with his mother about his plans for New Year's Eve.
You guys got plans for the night?
Yeah, nothing major though. I meet up with the fellas, head out to the city.
Why don't you take the train out there? That way you guys can drink and hang out and not have to worry about anything.
I feel like getting over there and getting back. I feel like waiting on no train.
No traffic either. You know it's going to be crazy going and coming back.
Okay. We might take it.
That's a clip from the film Fruitvale, which premiered in the U.S. dramatic competition at the Sundance Film Festival, featuring performances by Michael B. Jordan as Oscar Grant and the Oscar-winning actor Octavia Spencer as Grant's mother. The film is the directorial debut of Ryan Coogler, who also wrote the screenplay. Well, Ryan joins us now a little bit sick, but very happy about the response to this film. We welcome you to Democracy Now! Last night at the Eccles Theater, I don't know how many hundreds of people that place packs in, but it was packed. People were waiting outside, begging for tickets. Ryan, this is amazing, from living in your car to being a social worker at the detention facility in San Francisco to what you have presented here. Why focus on Oscar Grant?
Wow. Why focus on Oscar Grant? Well, I'm from the Bay Area. You know, that's where home is for me. My parents are, specifically the East Bay. I was in the Bay Area when Oscar was shot. I was home from film school on Christmas break. So I got a call like most everybody else did that a young dude got shot at the platform. And by the time I got back from where I was working at that night, it was early in the morning, and he had already passed away at the hospital. By the time he had passed away, the video footage of him being shot was already on the internet. It was already online. We were able to see it, and I mean, the interesting thing about it was that, you know, it was taken with cell phone cameras and video cameras from that time. So it was grainy. It was pixelated. Like, all you could tell that it was a black guy wearing a certain kind of clothes with a certain group of friends, and he looked like he could have been any one of us. Like, he dressed like all of us. You know what I mean? His friends like my friends. You know, it was several things, man. It was horrifying. It was frustrating, you know, because these things happen so often, and it was very, very, it put a sense of anger in everyone, you know what I mean? It definitely a sense of anger in me, and I think that's what happened when people went out to protest, you know what I mean? It was several peaceful protests, you know, some rioting, more peaceful protests than rioting, but the riots is what got reported more. But for me, you know, I've seen these kind of things happen before. Instances of police brutality and instances of urban violence, and people riot and rally, and I never saw. I saw it keep happening. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not a protester in the riots would help raise awareness, but I felt that myself as an artist and as a filmmaker, maybe I could do something that could help attack this issue at the root. You know, through my art, you know, through my outlet. Art has always been an outlet for me to get all my frustrations, to voice things that I like people to think about. You know, so I saw that as an opportunity for me to contribute, you know what I mean, to society. And I got into film to always make things that promote ideas of social change, you know what I mean? So it was the idea to make the film was kind of birthed there.
I want to play another clip from Fruitvale when the actor who plays Oscar Grant, Michael B. Jordan, he's in Parenthood for people who watch television, speaks with his daughter for the last time before he leaves to enjoy New Year's Eve with his girlfriend and his friends. He's speaking to his little girl as she stays behind. He calls her T. Her name is Tatiana, as she stays behind with her cousins.
You get ready to take off, okay?
You guys aren't going to sleep over, too?
We already promised our friends we was going to kick it with them tonight. But we'll be back before you wake up, though.
Yeah? No. Don't go. I'm scared.
Scared of what?
I hear guns outside.
You know, baby, those just firecrackers. You're safe inside with your cousins.
What about you, Daddy?
Me? Maybe I'm gonna be fine.
This is the dramatic footage of Michael B. Jordan playing Oscar Grant in the film, talking to his little girl, talking to Tatiana, what turns out to be for the last time. Ryan Coogler, the first-time filmmaker. But we're focusing on documentaries. This one, though, is not a documentary. Why, Ryan, did you decide to do this in dramatic form?
Wow, that's an excellent question. I love documentaries. Some of my favorite films are documentaries, and some advice that an amazing filmmaker gave me, Alexander Payne. I don't know if you ever heard of Alexander Payne or you know his work, but he told me that great directors should watch documentaries as opposed to watching fiction films so much because it's real people. But I kind of have a theory about docs in that it's very difficult to break the barrier of someone having a camera in their face. You know what I mean? People act differently when they know they're being filmed. So the best docs often take a very long time to make, for people to kind of get used to the camera being around and begin to be themselves again. So with the limited amount of time that I had, you know, I really wanted to get this story out there ASAP, you know, because these things keep happening. You know, I don't want to take 3 years. Excuse me, to make the best.
I just thank you for coming in because in our time here in Utah, it's 6 in the morning and that you agreed to come in.
No, thank you.
Especially at a time when, I mean, I have to just say, for you to understand folks all over the country and the world, what it means at Sundance for a film like this to, I mean, this is the film that's being talked about all over Sundance. In fact, it's rumored that the Weinstein brothers would have bought it for over $2.5 million. Is this true, Ryan?
They did acquire it. That amount is a bit bloated, but they did acquire the rights to distribute, so hopefully we'll see it in theaters nationwide.
And what does this mean to you? I mean, you were working at a detention facility in San Francisco.
I work when I'm in the Bay Area. I work as a counselor at juvenile hall. I work with the incarcerated youth, and I've been doing that since I was 21. My dad has been doing it since I was like, I think like 3 or 4 years old.
Your uncle, is it true, is Clarence Thomas, not the judge, but the former secretary treasurer of the International Longshoremen's Workers Union?
That is my uncle. He's been on your TV show quite a bit. That's kind of why I came in, because I knew my uncle would be happy. You know what I mean?
You want to say hi to him in the camera?
Oh, what's up, Uncle Buzz?
But you were living in your car at some point?
Yeah, that's also something that kind of, I saw in the news, that kind of got bloated a little bit. I've never been homeless in my life. I always had a home. When I first went to film school, however, because it was such a sporadic thing, I went down to Los Angeles, you know, and I didn't have anywhere to stay yet. So I kind of had to jump start in classes and things like that. So for about a week and a half, you know what I mean? I was you know, getting dressed in my car, spending most of my time in school, you know, until I found a place. But I bumped around quite a bit. I stayed with some Jesuits, you know what I mean, with a group of Jesuits that were in training, basically. I stayed with like a distant relative for a day or two, but I found my car to kind of be a safe haven for a little bit, you know, before I got an apartment.
So what was it like to direct this? I mean, you've got you have Octavia Spencer.
Right.
Talk about her role in this film.
Right. I mean, Octavia was you know, how we got, I wrote the script for Mike, you know, with Mike in mind. And I had a good idea that we could get Mike, because I felt like nobody had really used him for what he was worth yet.
You this know? Is Michael B. Jordan.
Yes, Michael B. Jordan. So yeah, he had done, you know, Friday Night Lights, he had done The Wire, he had done Parenthood, as you mentioned. He had done a few feature films that were very successful, but I'd never seen him in that lead role. And it was funny because every time I would watch him, I would want the camera to stay on him as opposed to going to whoever the lead was and whatever movie it was. You know, but with Octavia, I signed with WME after I finished the Sundance, you know, Screenwriters Lab. My agent, Craig Castell, was like, hey, you know, I think we can get this to Octavia for this mom role. And I was like, you're crazy. She just won an Oscar. You know what I mean? Why would she do this film for
no money? She won the Oscar for The Help.
Right. And you know, he gave her the script through her agent, and she ended up coming on board. She's one of the warmest human beings I've ever met in my life. Got a great work ethic, great energy, you know.
So you were directing this Academy Award-winning film,
I was. I mean, it was one of those things you can't think about too much, but it's also very motivating, though, you know, to know.
You know, there was an interesting question last night at the Eccles when this the movie played.
Right.
Someone raised their hand and said, what about the BART police? You did this on the in the BART station.
Right, I did.
So it was the BART police that killed Oscar Grant. Did they cooperate with you?
They did. They did cooperate with the film. And just a little bit of history about what happened was after Oscar's trial and everything happened with Oscar, pretty much all of BART kind of clean house. So I got a new police chief in there named Kenton Rainey. And he was much more open to us coming in, you know, and doing the film. Like, we made it clear up front that we weren't going to compromise our script. We weren't going to compromise what we showed. And they treated us basically like any other film, except we had a few more meetings. You know what I mean? But like they cooperated. Like they were on set. Never where we were shooting at, but like downstairs sometimes. You know.
So much of this was about the cell phone footage that so many people got when they were in the train as the real Oscar Grant was being killed, was being executed on the platform.
Right.
And that's a theme for you throughout this dramatic film,
right?
That has to do with Oscar just writing text throughout the day on his last day of his life.
Right.
Were those real texts? Did you know those from his phone?
Yeah. Well,
wishing his mom a happy birthday.
Exactly. Yeah, like, you know, when writing the script, you know, we went about it like it was a documentary, you know. Researching and talking to people that talked to Oscar on that day, and we found out that Oscar was a person that you know, loved to communicate. He was always around other people. When he was by himself, he was always on the phone with the people that he loved, always sending them text messages. So I thought that was kind of an interesting statement on society and people, how we connect with each other. You know, it was 2008. You know, had it been the year 2000, you know, when cell phones couldn't record, you know. We would have never heard about this case. It would have been somebody that got shot. You know, it would have been the cop's word against whoever else's, and there'd be no video evidence. You know what I mean? We have video evidence, and it's still, the offender got out in less than 2 years. You
well,
know?
I want to go to the real thing, and that is Oscar Grant's mother. In 2010, a jury in Los Angeles convicted transit officer Johannes Messerly of involuntary manslaughter for shooting Oscar Grant to death. He was later sentenced to 2 years in prison, served 18 months. Messerly acquitted on the more serious charge of second-degree murder and involuntary manslaughter. The jury included 8 women and 4 men. No African-Americans served on the jury. Members of Oscar Grant's family expressed shock that Messerly was acquitted of second-degree murder. And I want to go to a comment of Oscar Grant's mother, Wanda Johnson, who spoke outside the courthouse after the verdict.
That the system has let us down, but God will never, ever let us down. Though the system has failed us, though we fight continually, but you know what? One thing I know, that the race is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but to the one who endures till the end. And as a family and as a nation of African-American people, we will continue to fight for our equal rights in this society. The scripture tells us that the rich bribe the judges, and certainly we have seen the judges be bribed. Certainly we have seen how this judicial system has worked on such a case as this. We couldn't even get 6 hours of deliberation. evidence with the other jurors, but the jury had already had their minds tainted. And so I believe, I still remember what Dr. King said, that he had a dream. I believe that one day, as a nation of people, that you guys will not look at us according to the color or content of our skin, but that we would be treated right as a people. And my son was murdered. He was murdered. He was murdered. He was murdered. My son was murdered. And there, and the law has not held the officer accountable the way that he should have been held accountable. And I look at this, and I just say, like my brother said, to any other family who goes through this, do not give up. Do not give up. Even though this system will fail us and let us down, God will never fail us, nor will he let us down. And I will trust in him until I die.
Wanda Johnson, Oscar Grant's mother, after Johannes Messerly was sentenced to 2 years in prison. I think he served 18 months. With us, Ryan Coogler, the first-time film director whose film called Fruitvale, after the station where Oscar Grant was killed, is the rave of the Sundance Film Festival. Now, I interrupted you when you were talking about why you did this as a dramatic film not a documentary.
Right. Yeah. So I'm of the belief that documentary filmmaking, because the subject is known that the camera is there, it takes a long time for them to kind of let that barrier go, for them to start to be themselves, even though the camera is present. I know I didn't have a lot of time to get this story out, and I also know that with fiction filmmaking, because the character is acting, you could get the camera extremely close to them, and they're still being themselves. So I think that when fiction filmmaking is done well, it's a much better examination of a character. If you could pull it off, and I wanted this film to work in a way that lets you spend time with Oscar and you see him as a full human being on a day when he's really trying to be the best version of himself. That's possible. I think at the root of any issue of violence, you guys had the filmmakers from the square on, I'm from America and from the Bay Area where black on black crime plagues us, police brutality plagues us, and these issues of violence are basically rooted in the fact that one faction doesn't view another faction as full human beings, and in the Bay Area we have police officers that are paid to protect a certain area, and 9 times out of 10 they didn't grow up in an area that have the type of people that they're supposed to be protecting. So you have officers that grow up in, let's say, Napa County, where from the time they're born to the time they're 21, they may be interacting with a few black people in person, but what they see of black people, they see flashes of us. Picture guy wanted for this crime, wanted for that crime, shot dead on the street, shot dead here. That's not a human being. That's a flash in a section of this person's life, but not the full story. So these people are then given guns, and told to protect and arrest offenders in this area, and they don't view these people as complete humans. So I thought that through the guise of fiction filmmaking, we can let people spend time with a guy like Oscar, who never would have, and it was a blessing that we could bring this to Park City,
Well, Ryan Coogler, I want to thank you very much for being here, for directing this film, Fruitvale. It premiered here in the U.S. Dramatic Competition at the Sundance Film Festival. The awards ceremony will take place tomorrow night, Saturday, and we'll be reporting on it on Monday. The film, again, is called Fruitvale, and will soon be coming to a theater near you. Ryan, thanks so much.
Thank you.
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. Thanks so much for watching this report from Democracy Now!, your daily independent global news hour. We don't accept advertising or corporate funding, but rather rely on donations from viewers like you. Please make your contribution by visiting democracynow.org. We need your support today to keep bringing you this hard-hitting, in-depth reporting.